Over the last month or so, we have prepared the landlubbers for their ocean adventures by breaking down the seafaring tab. We have dove head first into the slimy world of kelp and discovered just how bloody good it can be. We ran along the coasts of the mainland and lunar beaches to find and cook lobsters alive for our pleasure, had the patience to fish for all sorts of ocean bounties in all sorts of waters, encountered beasts of the sea that could not be more polar opposite of one another, all the while being all around fun, had little fun with the likes of Wavy Jones and the terror claws of our nightmares, went mud fishing for debris and found all sorts of stuff afloat out there on the waters, and finally got around to actually baiting our rods to make life easier, even though we kind of found out that not doing so is actually the easiest thing to do. But whatever the case, everyone, it has been a journey, but we aren't quite done. I still get people asking how to actually identify parts of the ocean. So that's our job here today. Let's break down the ocean, one color scheme at a time. And what do I mean by that? Well, exactly that, everyone, because the layers of the ocean all have a distinct color to them, which will help us identify where exactly we are. That, and all the other identifiers that I will mention here today. But still, take the light greenish-blue color of the coastal ocean here. Of course, we're gonna know we're in the coastal waters as it's the closest to bloody land. But identifying this color could actually help you identify if you're sailing closer to the lunar shores, perhaps. But coastal waters are also where we will find bundles of kelp that we can either gather by hand or perhaps push with the help of a narwhale horn. Single pieces of driftwood will also be floating all about in these waters, and they're not actually technically flotsam. And we will also see schools of small ocean fish like runty guppies, needlenose squirts, bitty baitfish, smolt fries, and popperfish quite often to boot. Plus, come spring, expect the seasonal bloomfin tuna to be swimming around too. Now, the coastal waters don't truly have any danger present that can actually help us identify it further. However, I think we get the picture there. The swell ocean, on the other hand, though, the part of the water directly following the coastal ocean, with already a far darker blue color to it, is where we actually start to run into our first sea stacks. For the most part, they will be single stacks with plenty of distance between them, so I really wouldn't worry about them all that much. So, the part of the ocean that is right past the coastal ocean, easily darker in color as you can see, and has sea stacks. That seems pretty easy to remember. It is, but also recall that the swell oceans are where we can begin to see both narwhals and rockjaws begin to spawn alongside schools of mudfish, deep bass, black catfish, corn cod, and the remaining seasonal fish as well. So yes, the swell ocean is by far the busiest place on the water, especially when you factor in that some deep bass shoals can spawn in the swell ocean, and they may or may not see the albatross show up to boot. Good stuff. But already on to the rough ocean, everyone. One that may seem a bit difficult to actually spot any differences, but it's easier than you might think. Located after swell waters, rough oceans definitely have that deep ocean color to them with them dark blue blotches all around. But the more telling tell will be that of the insanely compact set of sea stacks that are dotted around the rough oceans. Rough oceans are incredibly difficult to navigate because of that. So thankfully, we don't actually really have to. Unless, of course, we're looking for seaweeds. Seaweeds only spawn in rough oceans, so if you see them, you know you're in the right place. And these mobs are incredibly dangerous, but offer some pretty interesting mechanics and loot, of which I believe we'll be talking about tomorrow. But here's where we will also find spittlefish for some unique crafts, more of the same medium ocean fish that we found in the swell oceans, but with the chance of a new one spawning in, the dandy lionfish. So, there you go. Now, hazardous oceans. Things that no one appears to get and always get mixed up with rough oceans. Hazardous oceans are just literally circles within rough oceans that have really dark water, have multiple boat fragments just floating around, is home to dandelion fish and dandelion fish alone, and really only have like one sea stack in the middle. Yup. It's just that easy, everyone. And I really wouldn't concern yourself too much about any of it, because the boat fragments only offer a single board if hammered. But lastly, the brine ocean. These salty spots can be found anywhere in the swell and or rough oceans, with the occasional spawning in coastal waters depending on world generation, and are obviously very distinguishable due to their salt formation sticking out of the water. But these parts of the oceans are very, very noticeable due to the color around them, because it is very, very bright. But chances are, you're really just gonna notice the cookie cutters and salt trying to sink ya before it's too late. Have fun. Now, some brief mentions here. Puffins replace all other birds out on the water. However, they are literally just crows in a different skin. Nothing special whatsoever, which kinda stinks. Schools of fish spawn every 15 to 60 seconds, with flotsam slash ocean debris spawning every 30 to 180 seconds. So chances are, there will actually always be something happening around you. Especially when narwhals and rockjaws have a chance to spawn with ocean school fish as well. But of course, the deeper you go, know that the longer it's going to take for you to drop and retract your anchor. So, be mindful there. And sure, if we're talking some greater ocean mechanics and such, some of which we obviously already have covered, there are Pearl's messages in a bottle that pop up all the time in all parts of the ocean, potential sunken treasures, skitter squids, and even the Crab King. But all these things either spawn anywhere they wish or have specific spawning constraints, so we don't really have to worry about that. What I do want to finish with is this. World generation and land branches could really mess with some ocean spawns. For Z, you can just easily end up with branches that lead to coastal, swell, rough, brine, and hazardous oceans all at once for Pete's sake. Or heck, even get an edge that is so dang close to the end of the world that it doesn't even make any sense. But speaking of, ever wonder what actually happens when we sail to the edges of the world? Do we just fall off? Is there a void out there? Well, unfortunately for us, it's nothing. It's just like a barrier that we ram into, and your boat gets damaged, and you might get a leak. So yeah, that's kind of a disappointment. But there you have it, everyone. This, coupled with all the other ocean guides over the year and a half we've been doing them, has likely ended our little seafaring series here. That said, I do in fact wish to return to both the Albatross and the Crab King to give them a bit of a refresh of sorts, and maybe cover seaweeds alone. But other than that, I think we've done it. We've sailed to the ends of the ocean of Don't Starve Together, folks. I hope you enjoyed it, and perhaps have gained a newfound appreciation for it all. Pfft, nah. Thanks for watching, and I'll see you in the next one. Bye-bye.